Good evening, sir. Sir, probably you're not joined with the speaker. Sir, unmute yourself. Yes, sir. The audibility has to be increased. The speaker volume. So you've connected?
Yes.
Your audibility has to be improved. Kindly come near the mic. So, would you try speaking? Then we can start off. As all the participants know, that we have been holding various vilifying sessions, which are being delivered by keynote speakers who have not only been the judges of the Supreme Court, sitting judges of the High Court, from various courts, not only from Punjab, Haryana, Kerala, Madras, Bombay, Calcutta. We have also on this platform had Advocate Generals, additional Solicitor Generals. The intent of the forum is that the knowledge is disseminated from the speakers who have immense knowledge. Amongst us today, we have the Senior Advocate, Dr. K.P. Sadasin, who is a distinguished speaker. The most distinguishing factor is that he's equally good in criminal law as well as in service matters. He is not only a lawyer, but he's also known for teaching. He in fact started his career as teaching in the law college, Calicut and Erinthalam. And thereafter he has assisted the High Court as well as Supreme Court in various issues which are peri-materia and have a far-reaching effect on the legal jurisprudence. He had been the CBI counsel for 16 years, and the fact that he's delivering he's a keynote speaker today on an issue which, as a student of law, as well as lawyer, judge, or for that matter, whosoever is in a government employment, is all the intent is to learn the various flips of the disciplinary proceedings. As to when the employee, what are the proceedings required for? When is the suspension done? When is the show cause notice issued? The charge sheet? When is the minor punishment imposed? When is the major punishment imposed? These are the facets which continue to stimulate the mind of a lawyer, student, and an employee. And at the same time, there are certain issues, despite the fact that you are reading it. But yet, once you hear it from a person with great eminence, it's always enriching for everyone. Thank you, sir. I, on behalf of Beyond Law CLC and Punjab University Chandigarh, welcome you again for this stimulating session from your side. Thank you, sir.
Mr. Garibald?
Yes, sir.
Okay. See, actually, the career of a government employee starts when he is getting an advice from the public. You know, the method of appointment in public service is either through public service commission or through employment exchange. or even
slightly your head will be, have to be on the higher side because your face is not visible.
Is it okay?
Yes, sir. Mm-hmm. No better.
Now it is better.
The mic, you will have to hold it by your hand.
Mic to hold your hand.
I'll just demonstrate because I am speaking through the loudspeaker. It's just like that. If you can hold the mic and you can do it like this.
Parallel. Now the Department of Government is also taking action in this.
Sir, kindly check the voice again at your end because people are just posting the message. It's not audible. You will have to either.
He has a primary responsibility to see that public interest is always protected. And suppose a government servant is not rising to that level as expected by the government or by the public. He is having a black mark by calling dereliction of duty and negligence of discharge of functions. For that purpose, normally the government has got a machinery to initiate disciplinary action against the government servants. In certain cases, it may go to that level where the government servant may involve or indulge in corrupt practices also. Wherein you can see that one government can initiate the proceedings by the police force, vigilance force, etc., etc.
So may I request, since it was not audible at the first instance, we can start from a scratch itself, from the first line itself.
Oh.
Right, sir.
Hopefully the appointment in a public service is made by the governments through public service commissions. This is a normal method of appointment into government service, public service. But in certain states, the public service appointment may not be resorted to due to various reasons because it may take a time-consuming process. The process of selection may go on and the screening effect will be different and it may change from people to people, race to race. So in certain states, they follow the practice of taking employment or taking the government servants through employment exchanges. Apart from these two normal methods, there are other methods also by which the government feels that a service of a particular person is highly essential for the ends of justice or for the purpose of discharging a public duty. Government can take that person also into service on contract basis, like agreement, mutual agreement, etc., etc. So when all these methods are admissible or available to the government, it is the option is always with the government to follow which is the best suitable method to select the best person. Once a person is selected and appointed by the government, he is called a government servant or a public servant. Why he is called a servant? Normally, that is a common question asked by the government servant, sir. We are after getting through this process of selection, after undergoing all these ordeals, and after undergoing a thorough study and every materials, and I am being scrutinized at various levels. Thereafter, I am appointed, but still you are calling me as a government servant. Why don't we call it me as a government officer? Why don't you call me as a public officer? Because the concept is this. Whenever a person is appointed to a government service, he is appointed to serve the people. He is not a boss. He is always a servant. His duty is to serve the public, serve the people, serve the governments. And that is why he is called as government servant and he is called as public servant. While discharging the duties of a government servant, it is just like extending the benefit to the public. So normally, a procedure will be prescribed. Normally, the rules will be there. Normally, the way in which he has to function is also well defined in the service rules. Suppose while discharging the duties by a government servant, he is not expecting or he is not rising to that level what is expected by the government. Or suppose his activities are not beneficial to the public, government can take initiative or government can initiate disciplinary proceedings against him. And suppose that government servant is involving in some unfair practices like corruption, like favoritism, like that, government can initiate a criminal proceedings against that particular person. So normally the government servants will face with a situation where parallel proceedings will be permissible. As regards government is concerned, government want to correct that government officer for which the disciplinary proceedings are initiated. As far as criminal proceedings are concerned, he has to be punished for the crime which is committed by him to the society. So the main question which was considered by the Supreme Court, whether two parallel proceedings, one under criminal law and one under civil service law, can be proceeded with. Earlier, the view was, once the criminal proceedings culminated in acquittal or he seemed to be innocent, no further proceedings can be continued along with the service law. And vice versa also. But now it is settled that the parallel proceedings can be continued because, one, that method of taking evidence in criminal procedure and the method of taking evidence in disciplinary action by the government are totally different. In criminal proceedings, you know that one, all elements of crimes, all elements are proof, and every chain has to be completed. Then only the criminal case will end either in conviction or in acquittal. But as far as disciplinary proceedings are concerned, normally no such, the evidences are not so much rigorous. The evidences are not expected to be as like a criminal proceeding, so that a formal inquiry is required. Now, I will be confining myself not to the criminal proceedings, what is preserved or what is being followed by the government and vigilance cases, etc. How the disciplinary action or departmental action can be proceeded against the government servant. Every departmental action starts by giving, normally when before starting a departmental action, a preliminary inquiry will be conducted. Some higher officer, some higher authority, when an allegation is received against a government servant, he will conduct a preliminary inquiry. That inquiry need not be an inquiry what we contemplate under the service law. It can be even a secret inquiry to collect the information whether the allegation requires a consideration by the government. Because normal sense, when people are discharging public duties, there are possibilities of making false and baseless allegations against a government servant. In either way, suppose an officer is very strict, then also people will revolt. Suppose an officer is incapable, then also the public will revolt. So normally, before initiating a disciplinary proceeding against a government servant, it is customary to have a preliminary inquiry by a superior officer. And because we want to protect the interest of the public as well as the interest of the government servant also, because his morale must also be protected by the government. It is a responsibility of the government to see that he is protected always. So, before initiating a disciplinary action against a government servant, it is customary to have a preliminary inquiry by a superior authority. And when that preliminary inquiry is done, it is not mandatory that particular government servant should be heard, because it's only a fact finding. It is actually not a procedure which is contemplated under service law. It is only to evaluate the circumstances under which whether we should proceed or not. So even without hearing the government servant, even without affording him an opportunity of being heard, the superior officer can conduct a preliminary inquiry. And if he feels that it requires a detailed inquiry, a detailed procedure is required, he can make a recommendation to that effect to the government. Then the government will start the disciplinary proceedings. The disciplinary proceedings are always started by giving memo of charges. Whether it is central service, started by giving a memo of charges. Memo of charges normally in service law consist of two parts. First one, the allegation. What is the allegation made against that particular officer? Second part of that is what the government intends to do. Whether the government want to go that way or et cetera. Because in our state also the law is totally different from other rules. One that's been followed by government of India is also having some difference. That you have committed certain such allegation which is a grave dereliction of duty or negligence or unbecoming of a government servant like that, an allegation is there, and it is proposed to implicate a punishment. It is an initial step by which an employee is subjected to a disciplinary proceeding. Along with the number of charges, the government is legally liable to provide the statement of allegations in detail. What are the allegations? What are the allegations against that particular government servant by the inquiry, which is going to be evaluated through the process of inquiry, and what are the detailed allegations which led to the leading or formation of these inquiry proceedings. So normally, along with the memo charges, the statement of allegations should also be given to the employee. And that is also now very recently appealed by the Supreme Court, saying that without a statement of allegations, if he gives simple memo of charges, it will not serve any purpose, because the government servant should know what is allegation against him. And only he can defend his case. So, along with that, memo of charges, statement of allegations will be given to him. Usually in service law, a printed format is provided, even in fundamental rules, mm-hmm. or the state rules also, how the memo of charges are to be given, how the statement of allegations are to be given. Normally, it is given very, very chronologically. It is arranged like that. The paragraph must be there. Each paragraph should contain specific allegation. And finally, the disciplinary authority must. And the disciplinary authority can either entrust the matter to by himself, or he can delegate it to somebody else who is subordinate to him. He can give the memo of charges and he can give the statement of allegations. And every government servant should be given an opportunity to submit his written statement of defense regarding the allegations. What is his version? Usually, he must be given an opportunity to peruse the documents. He must be given an opportunity to verify the records. He must be given an opportunity to see that the documents which is laid upon by the inquiry officer. After perusing all those documents and records, he can submit his written statement of defense. That is the first occasion under which a government servant can resist the allegations against him. After evaluating the written statement of defense, suppose the disciplinary authority feels that this is not satisfactory, a further inquiry is required. Naturally, the next step is, so this is the first stage. I am considering the step by step how that proceedings are being followed. First, you must give the member, once an allegation is there, a preliminary inquiry has to be conducted. After preliminary inquiry, if the disciplinary authority feels that the further probe is required, he may give a memo of charges along with the statement of allegations. Then the delinquent officer shall be given an opportunity to submit his written statement of defense. And after considering the statement of defense, if the disciplinary authority feels that further proceedings are to be followed, naturally he will be given and the matter will be appointed to an inquiry officer. An inquiry officer is expected to be a quasi-judicial officer. He can issue summons. He can examine witnesses. He can take evidences. He can verify documents. Whatever normal procedure is prescribed by law that he can adopt, he is just like exercising a quasi-judicial power. And the delinquent officer as well as the presenting officer will be present before him. And who are all the or what all evidences are laid upon by the disciplinary authority, all those documents and all those evidences will be produced before the inquiry officer. And the delinquent officer will be given an opportunity to cross-examine the witnesses, to controvert the documents, to verify the records. And after considering all those things, the government or the inquiry officer, inquiry authority, can come to a conclusion. In respect of each allegation, suppose the allegation contains seven numbers or seven allegations are there, out of which five are proved, two are disproved. Inquiry officer can come to a conclusion. This is the item number one is correct, item number two is false, item number three requires further probe, item number four and five are correct. Like that, he can come to a conclusion. The conclusion made by the inquiry officer must be a reasoned conclusion. He must give reasons for his conclusion. Only based on that, the inquiry report becomes a PACA report. That inquiry report has to be presented to the government, concerned the disciplinary authority. Inquiry officer only a fact-finding authority. He cannot take any final decision. On the basis of the report submitted by the inquiry officer, the disciplinary authority will come to a conclusion whether he should be given a punishment. And as per the service law, punishment consists of two types of punishments, namely minor punishments as well as major punishments. Minor punishment for simple offenses like a warning can be considered as a minor punishment. Censure can be considered as a minor punishment. Postponement of increment can be considered as a minor punishment. And the withholding of one increment can be considered as a minor punishment. Like that, these are all minor punishments. Suppose the disciplinary authority feels that because you know that one for imposition of a minor penalty, separate procedure is there. For imposition of a major penalty, the proceedings are totally different. Procedure is totally different. In the case of major punishment, like removal from service or dismissal from service or reduction in pension or reduction in emoluments or reversion to a lower rank, and all those are considered to be a major punishment. The proceedings for imposing a major punishment, a major penalty, and the proceedings for imposing a minor penalty are totally different. In either way, whether it is minor or major, suppose the proceedings are initiated for imposing a minor penalty, and while the proceedings are going on, the inquiry officer feels that he requires a major penalty. Or while the proceedings are started with imposing a major penalty, and during the process of inquiry, the inquiry officer feels that only a minor penalty is required. In either way, the authority has to give his findings to the disciplinary authority. After considering this finding, the disciplinary authority can take a decision. What is the punishment to be awarded? And when that such a decision is taken, he has to give a reasoned order along with a copy of the inquiry report to the concerned delinquent employee. So on the basis of the inquiry report, it is proved that you have committed such and such offenses, and I am proposing to impose a minor penalty, or I am proposing to impose a major penalty. Do you have anything to offer? And when that proposal is forwarded to him, along with the inquiry report, that is a mandatory provision earlier. You know that one earlier, this inquiry report is kept always in camera. They never give up. The inquiry report was not at all given to the government servant. But now it is gone that, because inquiry report is his own document, which he requires a vital document. And naturally, it has to be given to him, a copy of the inquiry report. On the basis of that one, the delinquent officer can offer his explanations, which may or may not be acceptable. If it is acceptable, okay, accordingly the punishment can be reduced. Or if it is not acceptable, the punishment can be rejected and the punishment can be imposed. Now the question is, once a punishment is imposed, this is a normal procedure by which a government servant can be punished by the appointing authority. Once the punishment seems to be not correct or not admissible, or the government servant feels that punishment is too harsh, or the punishment is not actually expected by him, he can file an appeal. Appellate authority is always there. In all government service, there will be an appellate authority. And he can move for an appeal before the appellate authority. Appellate authority will consider the entire aspects again. He is not an empty formality. Appeal is not an empty formality. And suppose he is not satisfied by the finding of the appellate authority, he can move to the government by revision. Revision can be taken over by the government either suo motu or on the basis of the application submitted by the delinquent employee. Revision of power is always with the government, because government is the ultimate master. Suppose the government feels that the punishment awarded to a servant is not proportionate to the offense committed by him. Suppose the government feels that the punishment awarded to him is excessive than what is expected to him. In both ways, government can call for the entire records and revise it. And that is why the revision of power is suo motu given to the government, not at the instance of the delinquent employee alone. And this is the normal procedure under which a punishment is inflicted on a government servant. The usual question is, when a punishment is proposed to be inflicted on a government servant, is it mandatory that the government servant should be kept under suspension? We always say that suspension is not a punishment, because during the period of suspension, he will get a subsistence allowance as provided in the Subsistence Act. And punishment, it cannot be termed as a punishment even, because he is given paid salary without doing any job. But the mental agony and trauma before the public, when an officer is placed under suspension, that has to be taken into consideration by the government. That is why in 2015, Supreme Court said that under no circumstance you can protract the suspension beyond 3 months unless the memo charges are given to the servant within that time. Now that judgment is, Devimar Chaudhary's judgment is being followed in all the other cases also now, even by the latest judgment, wherein the court said that no, you cannot place a government servant under suspension for indefinite period at the maximum. And what is the purpose of suspension? The purpose of suspension is to prevent him from manipulating the records. Because as long as he is continuing in service, he has got every opportunity to handle the records. To keep away from him, he shall not be given an opportunity to manipulate the records in his favor. Secondly, it is always better to have a fair trial when he is out. And only after evaluating these circumstances, the court may or the government may order to keep a government servant under suspension. And that is why he is given subsistence allowance also. That's why we say that one suspension is not a punishment. In all cases of disciplinary proceedings, suspension is not mandatory. Suspension can be invoked at any time as decided by the government. Even before the proposing the proposal to conduct an inquiry, an officer can be placed under suspension. The social stigma and the mental agony and the trauma that is going to be faced by the government servant should also be taken into consideration. That is what the Supreme Court said. So suspension is within the discretion of the appointing authority. And if it extends now it is well settled. Now if they extend the suspension period of suspension is extending more than 3 months, he has a right to be reinstated into service. Of course, the government can post him in a non-sensitive post, or a government can post him in some other place which is not easily accessible to him. But he shall not be kept under suspension beyond 3 months unless the charge sheet is filed within that 3 months' time. So you take it granted, suspension is not a punishment at all. And these orders are normally issued by the government in a routine manner. When government is issuing a routine order, government, you know that one government can issue orders. Only government can function through orders only. And that is why all government orders issued by the government are called SRO, statutory rules and orders. We call it as SRO. Even government of India is also issuing the orders only as SRO, means statutory rules and orders. And as far as Kerala is concerned, we have got three types of government orders. Routine orders, we call it as GORT. And the second one, GOP, we call it as the government order printed that got requires a series of air. And we call it as GOMS, manuscript also is there. So, whatever may be these orders are issued by the government, the ultimate aim is to purify the administration. And for purification of the administration, if the punishment becomes a mandatory, naturally the government servant has to be punished. There arose a question. If you are taking the extreme step of dismissal from service of a government servant on the basis of some allegations, can you call it as a purity of administration? That removal is, or the dismissal is ordered only for purifying that admission? Yes, we have got two explanations for that one. First one, the delinquent officer must feel that he shall not continue this corrupt practice. He is not. Second one, it must be taken as a lesson for the other government servants to see that this type of practices shall not be resorted to. But normal sense, you know that one, when a government servant is dismissed from service, entire service benefits are withdrawn. He is sent to the street without any, even for that one, no pension, nothing, no terminal benefits, nothing will be given. Considering the meritorious service rendered by the government servant, instead of dismissal from service, he can be directed to remove from service. Dismissal and removal are totally different. When we say in the common parlance, we see that dismissal is also going out of the service, removal is also going out of the service. But in the case of removal, the government servant will get the service benefits and he will also get pension depending on the decision taken by the government. And for that purpose, you know that when there are various kinds of pensions are there, invalid pension is there, the honorary pension is there, supplementary pension is there, loyalty pension is there. So many types of pensions are permissible, which the government can award. So dismissal completely denies the entire benefits, but removal gives him some benefit, which the government feels is just and reasonable. This is the consequence of dismissal or removal from service, which is a harshest method of punishing a government servant. The most harsh punishment that can be awarded to a government servant goes to that level only. In all other cases, the retrieval theory will be applicable because the government servant will get an opportunity to come back. He can get himself reformed. He can get himself as a lesson to the others. And all those other types of punishments are simple. But normally, when a government servant is imposed with even a minor penalty, it will create a stigma on the public. Not only that particular person, he has to face the public. He's sitting in an office. He has to deal with the public. He is always dealing with the human beings only. And suppose a person is given warning, even that will be reflected. Suppose one increment is barred, his disqualification for promotion will continue for 1 year. Suppose his 3 increments are barred. And even if it is without a cumulative, he will lose his seniority or 3 years, his promotion chances are gone. If it is with the cumulative, he will lose the 3 increments permanently. So naturally, the appointing authority should evaluate each and every fact and circumstance of the case before imposing a penalty. That is what we are normally challenging in the court. We will say the punishment imposed is disproportionate to the gravity of the offense. It is well settled by Supreme Court also. Every punishment must be disproportionate to the gravity of the offense. Suppose an ordinary clerk, you know that one, large scale corruption, say I am not coming because large scale corruption itself is a very hot subject which requires a considerable time. Suppose a clerk or a peon in a government office is accepting 10 rupees as bribe because of the financial stringency or conditions faced by that particular poor man. We will consider him as a great, it's a great offense. He is accepting bribery. But at the same time, the superior office in the same office may be collecting thousands of rupees, which goes unnoticed. And government will never take any action against him. What the poor man, what this peon in the office will think? What is the mechanism, machinery? What is the purpose of giving me a punishment if I, when I accepted 10 rupees for purchasing ration? My superior officer who is traveling in AC car is purchasing or gaining 1,000 rupees. Particularly, you know that one, this situation comes when in police departments. In police department, the constabularies will be normally collecting minimum amount and the higher-ups will be collecting maximum amounts. And they are expected to be the models to the subordinates, but the models, they cannot be followed as the models by the subordinates because the superior office is so correct. So many factors are there to be considered by the government while imposing a punishment on a government servant. It is not like a criminal offense or criminal punishment. Criminal jurisprudence is totally different. Criminal jurisprudence has nothing to do with the service law. It has absolutely independent status. That is why in the beginning I told you that the criminal proceedings as well as the service law proceedings can go simultaneously. Even if you are acquitted in a crime case, in respect of the very same allegation, departmental action can be continued with. Even if you are found to be or exonerated in departmental proceedings, in respect of the very same allegation, criminal proceedings can be continued with. Nothing prevents. So two independent aspects. These are the two fundamental aspects which have to be considered by a government servant as long as he is continuing in service. And that is the normal law also. Even, you know that one in higher level, higher ups offices, senior, very good senior offices are subjected to so many disciplinary action, departmental action like that. But unfortunately, in our legal system in India, we don't give any capital punishment for corruption. But there are certain countries in the world when a government servant is committing a corruption, that is a capital punishment. Purity of administration requires a harsh punishment. Purity of administration always requires severe punishment. Unfortunately, our legal system does not provide for that. Our legal system always says that at the maximum, suppose I looted money or I have grabbed money or I have misappropriated money from my own office, at the maximum what can be done is I can be removed from service. Or at the maximum I can be dismissed from service. I cannot be sent to jail by the authority concerned. That is one of the main weaknesses of service jurisprudence of India. No government servant can be sent to jail by the appointing authority. At the maximum, withholding a pension, removal from service or dismissal from service, maximum. And he is not restrained from, the only thing is he may be in certain cases, there may be a restriction, he may be declared as unfit to have any other government service. Employment in any other government service. But normally, such a restriction may not be imposed because that may not be applicable to, for example, a government servant who is removed from bank or the central government can get an appointment in a bank, or can get an appointment in a quasi judicial public sector undertaking like that, he can go for that. Nothing prevents. But countries are there where the purity of administration is maintained at the maximum level, where even capital punishment is awarded to government servants. When capital punishments are awarded, you know that one, just like the Gulf countries, once a punishment is strict and harsh, the possibility for committing the offense will be less. That is why now in India, the last year's survey actually shows that more than 23% of government servants are bad. That's an All India evaluation report. 23% of the government servants are corrupt. I tell you now, I am sitting in Kerala. I know that most of the, in Kerala, not 23, more than 23. Whenever all over India, it is only 23. But I don't know that all government servants are corrupt. All government servants are not corrupt. But even 1% is causing maximum damage to the society, because they are paid out of our own money. State exchequer is being spent for them. They are being paid the salary from the state exchequer only. And society expects something from them. And it is only for that purpose our hard-earned money, which is paid as a tax, that is being distributed to them. So normally the public has high expectations. And most of the cases, you know that one, ordinary people, for example, our Prime Minister has said, just before getting the relief in agriculture on this coronavirus, people has to stand queue for hours together because a particular village officer is very lazy. And what is the remedy available to the common man? Unless and until the machinery is very pakka, unless and until the machinery is very strict, unless and until the higher level officers are very correct and very strict, the system will not function. The human tendency, you know that one, always to be lazy, always become irresponsible, and everybody wanted to shirk from their responsibilities, to put it somebody else's shoulder. So it is of prime concern that the top level officers who are controlling the show must have absolute dignity, absolute integrity, absolute administrative capacity. These are the three basic elements which can lead to a normal functioning of a government system, to a government machinery. Every government servant is a part of this government machinery only. Nobody is an exception. As far as executive heads are concerned, you know that one? Executive heads, for example, ministers, they are not appointed. They may come and they may go. But government servants are appointed. If a person is appointed at the age of 25, he can continue in service up to the age of 60. No minister can continue up to the age of 60 if he is appointed as a minister at the age of 25. So, apart from the higher ministers are concerned, and apart from some higher IAS or senior level officers are concerned, all the others are subjected to service control only. And service control is the prime concern of every democratic country. Without a regular administrative control, without a regular evaluative control, without a performance evaluation, no government can function. And even in last year, Kerala, you know that one, the total number of files disposed by the Kerala government, government officials in the secretariat, are less than 10% only. 90% of the files are still pending. The employment force is always evaluated by the government on every 5 years. What is the resources available and what is the percentage of work increased during the past 5 years? After taking into consideration the volume of work, the number of employees will be determined. And that is how the evaluation process of work is going on. For example, 5 years back, the total population is only less than 1.2 crores. Now the population during the 5 years has gone to 2.5 crores. Need is increasing every day. Naturally, the workload will also be increasing. Corresponding increase in the personnel will also be required. That is why systematic evaluation is done, and based on which the service force is also increased. Hence, it is the only field where you can see that one. We call it as a white-collar offense. It is the only field where you can see that one. State exchequer is spent on public, state exchequer is spent on these persons to discharge public functions. And that is why we call them as government employee, we call them as government servant, we call them as public servants. I think I am stopping it now. If you have anything to ask, you can, or it's okay.
We can ask the questions to be posted on the group. Meanwhile, so Loni Gautam asks, are there any provisions such as we have company laws of whistleblowers for government officials? Are the employees of PSUs considered as government employees?
No. PSAU, PSU, public service standard takings, you know that when 51% is owned by the government only, then it will come to PSU. And in certain, if 51% is owned by the government, naturally it will come under PSU, then PSU government laws can be made applicable. Government laws or service laws are made applicable.
Right. Dr. Sunil Kumar, if all procedures of disciplinary proceedings are not followed by the employers, then what will be the effect on the penalty imposed on these proceedings?
That may not be sustainable in a court of law, because the two concepts will be examined by the courts when you are challenging the order passed in a disciplinary proceeding. First one, the basic principle of natural justice. That will be evaluated. Secondly, the court will see whether the rules of procedure is followed. For example, for imposing placing an government officer under suspension, Rule 11 is required. And what are the parameters or the directions contained in Rule 11 has to be, whether it has to be complied with. For imposing a minor penalty under Rule 12, whether this is a proceeding that is provided, whether the rules are followed. And that is for imposing major penalty, Rule 15. So naturally, the only defense or the only reason why what we can challenge it in the court is only based on these two aspects alone. The principles of natural justice, I am not given, adi altra partem is there. I am not given an opportunity to defend my case. I am not given an opportunity to be heard. These are the main defense that we can challenge the disciplinary order or proceedings. And secondly, the rules of procedure is not followed. Except that, simply by saying statement of facts, simply by saying that I am innocent, no court will interfere. In disciplinary matters, the courts are also very cautious. So unless you say that one, these are the legal lacuna what is committed by the disciplinary authority. These are the impropriety done to me by the competent authority. These are the violations of rules which is done by the competent authority. Which is a principle of natural justice, basic element is violated. Then naturally the court will interfere. So once a punishment is awarded, it's not going to be the end. It is subjected to a judicial review. And that judicial review will be there. And for that purpose, you know that 1985 Administrative Tribunals Act is there. And suppose you are not satisfied with the Administrative Tribunals Act, you can come to the High Court. And if you are not satisfied with the High Court, you can go to the Supreme Court. These judicial forums are also there. So any action taken by the disciplinary authority will be subjected to judicial evaluation later on.
So we have unmuted Manish Mittal. He will ask the question directly.
Please.
Hello.
Yes.
Sir, once a government employee has been acquitted by the inquiry officer, is there any logic for imposing any punishment upon him by the disciplinary authority?
I didn't get you.
So he says that, let's assume he is exonerated. Can the by the inquiry officer, can still a punishment be imposed?
No. This is nothing at all. Nothing. I'm concerned with the service.
I think what he is trying to say, probably Manish can make me stand corrected. Probably in that eventuality, if you are well aware, in that eventuality, let's assume the disciplinary authority is not satisfied. Then in that case, he can remit the matter for further inquiry, or de novo inquiry is not permissible.
De novo is not required. Further inquiry can be on.
Yes, further inquiry, and in that inquiry also will look into that matter.
It can be, need not be always by the same officer, by some other authority can also be appointed. Further inquiry need not be a de novo inquiry, but still some other officer can be entrusted to conduct the further inquiry. Because some of the cases we have come across, you know that one, even the officer himself will have an opinion that this particular officer is biased. He will not render justice to me. He can request the appointing authority to change it.
So sir, that would be a case wherein he says that the inquiry officer is biased. But his question, Manish, is that let's assume the inquiry officer is exonerated. Can the punishment be still imposed? I am saying it, The punishment cannot be imposed. At the most, it can be remitted back to the inquiry officer to give the report on particular certain aspects on that. Because once he's exonerated, then punishment cannot be imposed.
No. It is always with the government. Suppose an inquiry officer is not coming to the conclusion, logical conclusion in respect of allegation 1, 2, 3. Government can remit that matter to the inquiry officer, the same inquiry officer.
That's what I'm saying.
Government can direct to the same inquiry officer or some other officer to inquire it and submit it. But it shall not be at the risk of the government, because since the government is appointing another inquiry officer and getting a report in favor of him that as decided by the government, naturally it will create a doubt in the mind of the courts.
Mandeep Sajjan, in case a person is acquitted by a criminal court, can a disciplinary authority still impose a punishment?
Sure. Acquittal in a criminal case is not a bar.
Lovely. Is it compulsory to issue a show cause notice to the employee before the employer issues dissenting note? No, to issue a dissenting note. That is in respect where...
There is no question of any dissenting note also, because...
His case is also wherein dissenting note will only come once there is an exoneration by inquiry. So maybe the question is not complete.
No, the disciplinary authority can disagree with the finding of the inquiry officer. He can. Disciplinary authority can completely reject the inquiry officer's report. But in that case, the disciplinary authority must give a speaking reason why he is disagreeing with the inquiry officer's finding. After that, if the government feels or the disciplinary authority feels that a de novo inquiry is required, naturally the such and such aspects are not considered, government can refer the matter to some other officer. The only thing is government should pass a reason on.
So we are unmuting Lovely because he says that the question was not read the way he wanted. So we are unmuting Lovely. Meanwhile, I'm reading the question of Sandeep. Is DORI declaration by a government employee mandatory during the service? If a government employee commits a crime of giving DORI, how can such be crime reported and how does it?
DORI Prohibition Act is there. If he is doing anything illegal, that has to be considered as a punishment under the criminal law as well as in the service law also. Both action can be initiated against him.
So, Puneet.
Hi, Lovely.
Yes, Lovely.
Yeah, what can an employee do if an employer issue a Dyson order without issuing any show cause notice?
See, for issuing a Dyson order, show cause notice is not required because it is for the remuneration is always paid only for the services done by him. If the government feels that the particular person is not discharging his duties, and government makes a declaration by saying that unless you do the work, you will not get the pay, for which no show cause notice is required. It is already settled because All India Postal Union's employees work. They got a Dyson for 26 days. Supreme Court said no mandatory provision to give a show cause notice or anything. Unless you work, you won't get the pay.
Is there any time limit to contest that Dyson order?
No order, no time limit. Every government order has to be challenged within a reasonable time. Reasonable time depends on the facts of the case.
Thank you.
So, since there are some students also, may I request, how do you explain Dyson?
Pardon, Dyson means no work, no pay.
No, I'm saying on a different pedestal because all are not lawyers, some are students also. They would like to know what is Dyson.
See, a person is employed in a government service to do the duty for 30 days in a month. After 30 days, you know that one, he will get a statutory holiday for 7 days. Mm-hmm. Normally, it is 5 days, but it can go up to 7 days. And suppose after 7 days, a particular person is not coming to the office and discharging the duties. Even individual cases, Dyson may not be declared. But in collective organization, suppose a group of employees are resorting to strike by saying that we will prohibit the work for 3 days. And in that, even government can take a policy decision that we will not give you the pages unless you work during these 3 days. That is called, in simple terms, we call it as Dyson law. So it is a policy decision of the government. In certain government, for example, in Kerala, the present ruling party, they were having a strong employees union called NGO union. And they resorted to all sides of strike during the previous regime. And there the government always declared the policy, if you go on strike, we will not give you the salary. Unless you work, how can you claim the salary? It is not a punishment. It is only a withholding of the remuneration because you don't work.
We have unmuted Puneet. Puneet, ask your question.
Good evening, sir. Sir, my question is, when we are dealing with the terminal dues of an employee, there will be two situations. That one, the disciplinary proceedings were initiated prior to his retirement.
Correct.
So when we retire that employee, so how do we treat his terminal dues? And for example, when he retires, but we come to know about any misconduct after retirement. So
The answer is very simple. Any disciplinary action can be initiated against the employee only when he is in service. If there is any pecuniary loss to the government, disciplinary proceedings can be initiated even after retirement. In the case of pecuniary loss to the government alone. In all other cases, the disciplinary proceedings has to be initiated prior to retirement. And suppose he suffered or he caused a loss to the government, that loss can be recovered from his terminal benefits. But now the latest judgment Supreme Court says from DCRG, death accrual retirement gratuity, you cannot withhold. But his pension can be withheld. 50% of the pension can be withheld until the loss is realized by the government. But the disciplinary proceedings must be initiated prior to his retirement unless there is monetary loss. If there is monetary loss, the disciplinary proceedings can be commenced and continued even after retirement.
So, but that would be in an eventuality where there is a relation, pension. But what about a case where there is no pension scheme?
Government servants always have pension.
No, at least in our places. Board corporations.
Sir, in PSUs,
they don't have pension. It's not a pensionable service. In that case, his terminal benefits will be forfeited.
No, but
the quantification must be done before releasing it.
No, but it sometimes so happens that before his superannuation, the inquiry report has not been submitted, nor the punishing authority has been able to come to a conclusion.
See, when a person is in service, everybody knows that he is late of retirement. And if he's last minute, you know that one, suppose a person is retiring on 30th of September 2020, and we come to notice about his illegality in September 5th or September 10th, the date of retirement can be postponed. He need not be made it to retire.
Just one more thing.
Please.
Sir, can we set off the loss? Suppose the disciplinary authority prior to retirement quantifies the loss. And the terminal dues also are being prepared. So can the disciplinary authority pass an order to set off the loss from the terminal dues?
Yeah, very much. Okay. Nothing prevents.
Sir, but sir, at time court says that why you are touching the gratuity or PF of the employee.
No. Gratuity is actually not considered to be. Gratuity is only a deferred payment. Gratuity cannot be, even though we pay it at the time of retirement, gratuity cannot be called as a payment made out of gratitude. It is only actually that earnings. Please.
Sir, but at times Supreme Court says that gratuity and these benefits are not the bounty of the employer. So,
That is only that they say that pension is not a bounty. And that is the same reason now given to gratuity also. That is the same reason. But suppose the loss is caused to the public sector undertaken by that government servant, it can be definitely recovered from his terminal benefits. Other than gratuity.
Thank you, sir.
Devika. We have unmuted Devika. She practices in the Punjab and Haryana High Court. Devika, you can ask the question directly.
Sir, very good evening. My question is, sir, in most of the cases, we see that even when the delinquent employee, while he is in service and an inquiry is conducted against him, either he's exonerated, is absolved of the charges, or a punishment is awarded to him. After, for example, let's say he has served the punishment, nowadays we see he's harassed while after he's retired, he's harassed that while you were in service, an inquiry was conducted against you, so we are not releasing the retirement benefits. So, sir, is it decide what can be done?
No, the problem is, suppose a government servant is causing loss to the government while in service, and it becomes unnoticed by the government until his retirement. That is a simple question. After retirement, if it comes to the knowledge of the government, government can initiate disciplinary proceedings and government can realize the loss from him. That is why, except in the case of monetary losses, no disciplinary action can be initiated after the retirement. But in the case of monetary losses, even after retirement, the proceedings can be initiated. And it could be recovered even from his terminal benefits or withholding pension like that. In public sector undertaking, suppose there is no pension is there, before disbursing all these terminal benefits, that has to be evaluated and everything has to be calculated prior to his retirement itself.
So we are unmuting Varun, Varun Garg. If anybody has a question, they can post it in the chat box. Varun? Meanwhile, I can read the question of Varun. What is the remedy if disciplinary authority does not initiate proceedings against the delinquent officer, even if there is negligence or part thereof by the delinquent officer?
The disciplinary authority must be pakka and he must be vigilant always. It is his responsibility only to break the administration normally. Suppose he himself is delinquent, or if he is careless, only God alone can save him.
So, Raghu, whether malpractice in appointment exams, does it amount to it should be dereliction of duties of a government officer?
Yes, definitely.
Varun, you can ask the question directly.
Good evening, sir. Sir, 2014 Lalita Kumari judgment have been delivered by Honorable Supreme Court of India. In clear words, Honorable Supreme Court said FIR must be registered by officer in charge of the police station. When they refused to register an FIR, then matter went to the higher officer, like Deputy Commissioner of Police and DCP in state.
Okay.
So they still don't, they themselves negligent, and Supreme Court clearly said that even after taking, means they have to take action within the 15 days. If they do not take action within 15 days, disciplinary inquiry should be started against the erring police officer. But they refused to do disciplinary inquiry, and they even refused to pass any action regarding direction to register an FIR. So what is the remedy left with the citizen? My first question is whether it is the prerogative of disciplinary authority to initiate disciplinary action. And second, what is the remedy left with the citizen in this situation?
See, citizen, suppose the police does not register an FIR when you make a cognizable offence. It's left to the citizens to move directly to the court by filing a complaint, private complaint under Section 190. And as far as the government, the police officer who refuses to register the FIR, you can move to the higher authority, for example, DIG or IG or DGP or state police chief. And suppose they refuse to take action against a particular officer, you can invoke the jurisdiction under 226 before the High Court.
Thank you, sir.
Sir, thank you. The questions will keep on pouring. One. Mandeep Sajan, we are unmuting him. They want to ask a question directly. Mandeep? Then there's another, Dr. Tanaji Rathod.
Hello.
Hello.
Yeah, sir.
Sir,
when an employee, he has been dismissed with a 3-increment cut.
Okay.
And after, again, he has retaken to employment.
Okay.
His seniority will go down, or it will be maintained status quo.
No, he will be, once his increment is cut and is removed from service, that increment which is already deducted cannot be recovered again.
Yeah.
Even if he is re-inducted into service.
Yeah, his seniority will be maintained.
Seniority will not be permitted, provided he is dismissed from service, he cannot claim, or else he can claim the seniority.
He has retaken to the employment.
Retaken to the employment, first removal is actually a removal from service or dismissal from service?
Dismissal from service.
Then he cannot.
His seniority will come down?
Come down.
Okay, thank you.
So, it sometimes so happens that a person is entitled to be considered for promotion, but his case was kept in a sealed cover. And eventually...
That procedure is followed in fundamental rules only because for every selected post, a Department of Promotion Committee meeting is required. And Department of Promotion Committee meeting consists of the head of the department, the UPSC member, and all those the prime superior authority and all those five persons will be there. It is practically impossible to hold the meeting on every occasion. Suppose a government servant is due for promotion, is facing some departmental action. They can conduct a claim, can consider his claim and put the finding in a sealed cover. Once the departmental proceedings are over, that cover can be opened and then he can be given promotion. That is the only facility provided for that.
So that I can understand that is from the KV Janakiraman judgment. But eventually, let's assume a minor punishment is imposed.
Minor punishment does not stand in the way. Then he will get to seniority everything from the date when he became due. The only thing is they need not convene a new DPC.
Then the only the seal cover
has to be open. That's all.
Right, sir. Now, we are unmuting Tripti to ask the question directly. Yes, Tripti. Triptijit, you can ask the question directly. No, she's not. Sir, Varun Mahajan, what if the investigating officer? She's coming. Tripti, you can ask the question directly. Triptijit. Azad Singh, whether illegal arresting done by an IO comes under his official capacity or not, whether he can not be prosecuted for this or not.
He can be prosecuted. Illegal arrest is not, but DK Basu's case is there, West Bengal. If an officer IO is committing an illegal arrest, he can be prosecuted. That IO can be prosecuted.
Nidesh Bankar.
Ten commandments of the Supreme Court in DK Basu's case.
Okay. We are unmuting Nilesh. He's an IATN. He wants to ask a question. Nilesh? Nilesh Bankar.
Hello?
Hello?
Hi, sir, I'm working in DRDO Pune. I got selected in IIT Goa.
Okay.
But I want to take lean, the 2-year period. But my current working organization, it is an autonomous government organization under MOD. They denying me lean. So is it possible to approach court?
No, unless the service conditions provide for lean, you cannot claim lean as a matter of rights.
It is not my right, sir.
No. Because government services give leave for 3 purposes. For educational purposes, for joining spouses, and for accepting alternate employment. But in these 3 cases, the lien will be retained provided government will give you the lien. In case of public sector undertaking, they don't have such a policy.
Okay, sir. Now it is autonomous organization, sir, under Ministry of Defense, and I'm selected in IIT Goa.
But that is true. But they don't give you for educational loan, the education leave, they don't sanction, naturally you will lose. Or you can write to the government and get sanctioned.
Okay, sir. Thank you, sir.
Azad Singh.
asks.
Okay, sir. Is it?
Okay. So I think the question will continue. it was a wonderful session. I, on behalf of Beyond Law CLC, as well as ULS Punjab University Chandigarh, would like to thank you for giving insightful session. The initial hiccups and thereafter the session going well, it says that try and try, you will succeed. And it was a clear example that we just persisted with the work, and it also gives us the motivation that even during the lockdown, sometimes the mind is locked with a negative mindset. But if we persist with the positiveness, the thought process will get positive and we will succeed. So thank you on behalf of participants.
In the meanwhile, 3 months back, I visited Chandigarh ICO. I argued a matter. I got an order in my favor. I appeared for a company there in Chandigarh.
Okay. That's a good way. It was, if you would have known, then we could have got connected. But this platform shows that the boundaries and this thing are no barriers. Here we have been able to learn the entire nitty-gritties of the service law, which definitely comes in the mind of anyone. But once it is being dissipated through a person who has immense knowledge, it only enhances the knowledge. And the person who was already having some knowledge, but the finer nuances can always be learned by an expert, which we learned today. And we are all indebted for the knowledge you have imparted. The participants who have participated, we are also thankful. Those who participated on the Zoom application as well as on the Facebook. Okay. Stay connected. Tomorrow we have a webinar by Justice J.R. Mehta, who is judgments on the motor accident claims are itself path breaking. Many of his judgments and the way how to proceed further have been also not followed strictly, but those judgments have been upheld by the Honorable Supreme Court. Stay connected. One can always see that Mr. Mehta's judgments on the motor accident claims are themselves path breaking and enlightening for everyone. And he will tell us how to expedite the claims in a time-bound manner, not the structural process which we are generally following. So tomorrow at 5 p.m., on behalf of Beyond Law CLC and ULS Punjab University, I welcome you all to yet another webinar. Thank you, sir. Stay blessed.
Thank you. Thank you.
Stay blessed and stay safe.